Is it just me, or is everybody prescribing Medrol dose packs for like everything?
Find out today on Medical History Mysteries.
It's interesting because if I have a patient with TMJ, or maybe if there's somebody who's got a tooth that's bothering them and it's like, it's not endo, but we're not really getting them comfortable with occlusal adjustments or whatever. All my friends are always like, prescribe a Medrol dose pack. Go ahead and do that. And that's kind of their go-to to things. And it makes me wonder, is the Medrol dose pack the pain equivalent in dentistry to my big fat Greek wedding's Windex?
Well, I love the reference. That's a good one. So as a pharmacist, I've had a lot of experience with the Medrol dose pack over the years. You know, I've seen Medrol dose pack as long as I can remember. It's probably been around as long as I have, which is a pretty long time. And I will tell you that while I've often seen it used, it was normally used for inflammatory reactions, you know, significant inflammatory reactions, significant allergic reactions. So poison ivy and bee stings and maybe a flare up of rheumatoid arthritis or that sort of thing. But I've always found its use in dentistry a little questionable because I don't know what we're trying to accomplish. I'm not saying you shouldn't use it. I've seen plenty of Medrol dose packs prescribed in dentistry. And I think, you know, again, I would never want to tell any dentist how to prescribe. But what are you trying to accomplish? It's a couple of days of therapy. And while that may not be a bad thing, I would think that in the practice of dentistry, when you want to treat inflammation, you want to use something that's high potency so that you use one or two doses. And it's over, right? We don't want the continued dosing of a steroid, even though it is a decreasing dose every day. I don't know if we want to continue something out that many days when in reality, we're not looking for that. We're looking for fast in, fast out. So my go-to when people have asked me about this has always been dexamethasone. Again, dexamethasone is pretty potent and it comes in various strengths. You've got to know what strength to use based on the condition. But the beautiful part about dexamethasone is you're in and you're out. You know, it's one or two doses, right? Done. And it does have a latent effect. It can last up to 48, sometimes 72 hours. So you get everything you want out of Dex without having to continue the therapy beyond, you know, a couple days with a Medrol dose pack. And again, I'm not saying methylprednisolone is not potent, but it's not as potent as dexamethasone.
Can we make a hierarchy thing? So we've got, I mean, they're really, the spirit of this is anti-inflammatory, right? So when would you say, all right, I'm going to bring in a muscle relaxer like Flexeril or something like that for TMJ versus an anti-inflammatory, like a steroid anti-inflammatory, or why wouldn't you just use Tylenol and ibuprofen or something like that as well? So when would you use that versus that versus that?
Right. So, okay. First of all, let's keep in mind that skeletal muscle relaxants, as they're described to us, do not relax your skeletal muscles directly or per se. Okay. They basically cause central nervous system depression, which relaxes your skeletal muscles. So it's kind of like make you drowsy and you're relaxed and all your skeletal muscles were relaxed too. I'm not saying I wouldn't use it in TMJ. It certainly has its uses, but you know, then you've got to be cautious about a patient using it while they're trying to drive or using it while they're at work, and that can be problematic. A steroid might accomplish everything we're looking for because it is anti-inflammatory, and treating TMJ in that way may be the better of the two. As far as using ibuprofen and acetaminophen, and I always say use those two together because of their complementary action, I think there's a place for that in TMJ, but probably not as much as either a skeletal muscle relaxant or a steroid because they're not really designed to work that way. Ibuprofen and acetaminophen really are designed to treat pain that sort of flares up and not, and then flares up and then not. And TMJ is sort of like this chronic, you know, myofascial pain ultimately that I believe really responds better to either a steroid or a skeletal muscle relaxant or both used in conjunction.
Interesting. So is it true you should be taking steroids with like some kind of dairy, like milk or something?
Yeah, they'll always recommend taking a steroid with food or milk because it can be very irritating to the lining of the stomach and that ends up causing nausea. And if you vomit up, then you can't take you know, then that dose you just took is gone and you have to start over again. And it becomes a vicious cycle. So something with food and milk in your stomach is a better idea. But if you've just had dental work done, how can you eat or drink anything? So again, it's a bit of a catch 22. Normally something like Ensure perhaps, you know, or a thick liquid. I've often said even milkshakes will do if necessary. No straw, right? Very important if you've done an extraction or whatever. But something that's thick and heavy in your stomach will help cushion the blow of that steroid. Because believe me, you don't have something in your stomach and you take a steroid on an empty stomach, you're going to remember it for the rest of your life. Yeah.
Yikes. Is there anybody that we don't want to prescribe a steroid for?
Got to be really careful with patients who are already on medications that alter their immunity. And if you're like me and you've watched enough TV, you know, at some point I just call it just another MAB, because every drug that's advertised on television, the generic name ends in MAB, monoclonal antibody, or NIB, which means it's a tyrosine kinase inhibitor, or one of those drugs. Bottom line is all those drugs alter immunity. Using a steroid may not be the best option in those patients. Also, patients who have diabetes, we all know that steroids can alter blood sugars. So again, you may not want to give a steroid to someone who has type 2 diabetes or even type 1 diabetes, because it could alter their blood sugar significantly.
Wonderful. All right. Well, there's more to this topic, right? I mean, you really can't cover it in one medical history mystery. So again, like we talked about last time, like go to Tom's lecture. Don't go to mine for this. Like go to Tom's for this for sure. And so obviously if you need to do a deeper dive, there's a lot to be learned there. So I think we have more to talk about in the steroid situation.
Let's go for episode number 2. How about that? Sound
all
good?
Right. To be continued, everybody. We'll see you next week.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye.
Bye. Thank you.